I'm Jim Hoskins.
And I'm Jason Seifer.
Welcome to the Treehouse Show, your weekly dose of internets, where we talk about all things web development, web design, and more.
In this episode, we'll be talking about HTML5 APIs, responsive background images, and our app of the week is SQL Pro. Nick Pettit is out this week due to a bizarre faux hawk accident. So let's get going. First up this week is a project called Backbone.viewkit. Backbone.viewkit is a Backbone.js plugin for managing views and transitions, and it's primarily targeted towards mobile devices. If you've seen a project like jQuery Mobile, this gives you very similar transitions to use on your websites.
Sort of like move the pages side to side and like all those swipe things from iOS?
Yep, just like that. What they're trying to do is really kind of approximate more of what a native mobile application is going to look like. It doesn't give you too much stuff to work with in the way of fluff, but we have a little demo that you can see on the site. It's up on a JS Fiddle right here. They have a top navigation bar as well as a view right below it. And then you can see as you click between these different views, it slides around using Backbone.js to just render your different views and manage these very easily for you. So this is a really neat plugin. You can check it out. We'll have a link to it in the show notes. It's over on github.com.
Ah, very cool. So I got a cool tool called the Noise Texture Generator.
That does sound cool.
It does exactly what it says, actually. It generates noise texture. And the reason this is cool is it allows you to update the opacity and manage the noise density. And what this is good for is it will allow you to create a background on your site with some very subtle sort of noise on it, which really isn't something that is super noticeable, but it's a nice little effect that you can have to sort of break up the page using CSS. So basically, you could have a color either defined directly in the image, which you can see here, or you can have it actually be a transparent noise texture and then overlay it on a CSS colored background so you can be a little more dynamic. You can adjust the size of it, and then it exports as a PNG, which is pretty cool, and then you can just use it on your site.
Really nice. Kind of ties the room together.
Yeah, it's a little thing.
So next up, we're going to be talking about five HTML5 APIs that you didn't know existed. I find that a little bit presumptuous, and I'm just going to say you may not have known that these APIs existed. This is over on David Walsh's blog, which he's called the David Walsh Blog. So kind of a cool few things that you can work with HTML5 is the full screen API. Different elements can request that your browser actually go full screen. This does require user approval and permission, so you can't just launch your website full screen. We all remember how pop-ups went back in the late 90s.
Probably a good feature.
Yeah. Next up is something called the Page Visibility API. This lets you listen in on events like when a user focuses on a page's tab or if a page is up in another window. Now, I'm not entirely sure if this lets you focus on a page when somebody navigates away from it or it's hidden, because I think that would be a great time to play a background sound like, hey, come back to me. I'm this page that you were looking at. I mainly find all these useful for different pranks. There's also the Get User Media API, which lets you use the MacBook's camera, as well as the battery API, and link prefetching. If you want more information on these, as well as code samples, check out the link in our show notes, which you can find at youtube.com/gotreehouse.
Yeah, it all seems like pretty good prank technology. Including the webcam, which is pretty scary.
Yeah, I like that we've kind of evolved the web to a point where we have so many options for pranking people when they go to our website.
Well, I got something that's not really very prank-worthy, but it's a great article from Rolf Timmermans about responsive background images with fixed or fluid aspect ratios.
Oh, cool.
And it's a description of how to create responsive images that have aspect ratios that either stay the same as they resize through the responsive spectrum, or you can even set it up so that the aspect ratio will change as the page resizes. The way that they're doing this is instead of having an image, using a figure and setting the actual image as the background image, and then using the actual sizing of the figure element itself. And by using some CSS and some math, you can set the aspect ratio so it appropriately sizes as you go on through. At the bottom, he also has some CSS code, which allows you to do all the calculations in code instead of actually typing it into your calculator and hard coding it into your CSS, which is pretty nice.
that's pretty clever by using the figure to do the background image.
It's still semantically correct, I guess, although, you know, if background images don't work, which I guess is pretty much a problem that's not a problem anymore, especially if you're worrying about responsive design, it should be pretty compatible, so I really wouldn't worry about it.
Oh, still pretty neat solution.
Yeah.
Next up is our app review. Our app review this week is an app called SQL Pro. This is going to let you manage your MySQL databases on Mac OS X or OS X, as some people say. Now, what this provides a nice little GUI for interacting with your MySQL database. This is going to be different from a project like PHP MyAdmin in that it's working only on your local computer. So here's what it looks like. This is just a little test database with a test table that I have up on my local machine here. And as soon as you select the table, it shows you all of the different fields that you have in the database. And then you can even add more fields as you go on. You know, if you want to add an integer, go ahead. And then here's another thing, other field. Even provides you a little drop down, just giving you all the different options for table columns. You can even check out the content in the database and just double click in there to add different content. And gives you a really nice way of working with databases on OS X. There's more options like viewing different table infos and even doing custom queries from right inside the GUI. We'll have a link to this in the show notes. I believe you can get this at sqlpro.com. It's completely free. They're not sponsoring the show because it's free, but you can donate if you like the project. And once again, that's at sqlpro.com. Kind of a neat thing.
Yeah, usually I've seen a lot of those projects that try to manage the database in the GUI, and a lot of them can be pretty janky, but that one looked like it was pretty smooth, pretty well-designed, and easy to use, so I'm excited to try it out.
Yeah, it's pretty nice. Next up, we have a project called Editable for Bootstrap. This is a set of JavaScript plugins that work with Twitter Bootstrap to let you do an approximation of in-place editing with different fields. So here's an example that they have on the site. There is a field for username. You can actually click in there and then change it to something else. You click the little check button, and it edits right in place and updates the HTML client side. This works with all sorts of different field types, including dates. It gives you a little date pop-up. Click the check mark and wait, pretty much anything you need. There's also a ton of different events that you can hook into, and it's pretty easy. It works with jQuery and Bootstrap greater than or equal to 2.0.4.
So is it actually editing sort of form fields and the idea is to submit them through, or is it actually editing sort of in-place content and then you'd have to handle it in JavaScript? What's the goal of this?
It's editing in-place content and then you handle that in the JavaScript.
So you have a callback with the new content and then you could use Ajax or something to update the server or page.
Yeah, and it gives you a great and pretty thorough API to work with.
Oh, that's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Well, I got a cool jQuery plugin.
Sweet.
It's called jPanelMenu.
What does that do?
It creates a panel menu in jQuery.
Wow.
Hence the name.
I don't get the name, but okay.
Everything cool starts with a J. But
agreed.
If you've ever used the mobile apps for Facebook or Google, you're probably familiar with that little menu that's sort of behind the application. You either slide it or hit a little button and it kind of comes out in a little list. Well, this allows you to make it pretty easily. You install it, and then you click the button, and your whole page moves to the side, and you have a nice, well-designed little menu that you can click, and then they're just normal links, and you can just move it right back. It even has animations. It's pretty cool. The only thing that I'd say to watch out for is that the way that it works is when it's activated, it'll actually take all the content sort of from your body and move it into a div, which it then moves to the side. And so if you have any JavaScript or CSS that is expecting elements to be directly in the body, it is slightly changing your structure, so you may have to watch out for that.
Gotcha. Good tip. Cool plugin. I really like it.
It's pretty cool.
So finally, we're going to wrap this up by a blog post on what every programmer absolutely, positively needs to know about encodings and character sets when working with text. This is a very, very thorough blog post that provides a fantastic introduction to what's actually happening behind the scenes on your computer when you interact with any kind of text in a programmatic way. It's not as simple as just writing single letters and characters to the screen. We have all sorts of different encodings and encoding styles.
So to get into ones and zeros, you have to have some sort of way of defining what ones and zeros mean what, right?
Yep, exactly. So this is not something that we're going to cover completely on the show, but we do want you to read this whole thing because there is going to be a quiz next week on the Treehouse Show episode 19.
All right, prepare yourself.
Yes, definitely be prepared. So that's it. That's all we got for this week. Jim, who are you on Twitter?
I am Jim R. Hoskins on Twitter.
And I am at J. Seifer. If you want more information on anything that we talked about this week, head on over to our YouTube channel at youtube.com/gotreehouse.
This episode was brought to you by Treehouse, the best way to learn how to design and develop web applications, websites, and mobile apps. Check us out at teamtreehouse.com.
We'll see you later.